You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. Your next stop.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us tonight on A Word from the Lord. My name is Caleb Robertson. I'm filling in for James Oldfield tonight. I believe he's got a sore throat. And so tonight we're going to somewhat pick up where Mark left off. I don't know what the beginning half of Mark's show was, but I do know that the caller that I believe was the last caller who called in and talked about the Holy Spirit, and I couldn't really make out a lot of what he was saying. I just kept hearing him answer to Mark, well, what'd you do that you think you're saved? And he just would respond, the Holy Spirit. Well, that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Confusion on the Holy Spirit. And what we're really going to talk about and try to hit on tonight, a lot of people have this wrong idea about the Holy Spirit. You know, some people will make the statement of, well, your spirit isn't really filling with my spirit, and we need to make sure that we're matched with the Holy Spirit. Or they'll say, you know, as soon as I came into the building, the Holy Spirit came over me and I just felt right. I felt like I was in the right place. We've asked people before. I've asked them in, you know, private Bible studies. I can remember one man, I asked him, how do you know which church is correct? And he just said, well, if I feel the Spirit moving when I come in, then I think I'm in the right place. And so tonight we're going to ask, is it my spirit, is it your spirit, or is it the Holy Spirit? Because there's going to be a difference. And we're going to cover that in the text. We're going to look at several verses to show that feelings that we have, whether it's feelings of hesitancy, consternation, we feel anxious, it doesn't have to be, and it's not going to be the Holy Spirit, but instead it's going to be your own spirit that makes you feel those certain ways. A lot of people say, you know, even with the idea of when someone says that they think they were saved because they just felt so good and felt so at peace. Well, you can feel those ways for believing a lie, but that has nothing to do with the Holy Spirit coming on you. Now, I'm going to give you an example tonight about confusion from the Holy Spirit. Before we get into it, let's just look at a text from 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Now, look what he says in 1 Corinthians 14. He's telling them in verse 22, tongues are a sign, not for them that believe, but to them that believe not. But prophesying serveth not to them that believe not, but for them which believe. If therefore the whole church be come together in one place, and all speak with tongues, and there shall come into that are unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that ye are mad? Now the reason they would say mad is because everybody would be speaking in a different language, and there be no interpreter. Now look what he says in verse 24. But if all prophesy, and there come in one that believeth not, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, and he's judged of all. Look what they were doing. How is it, brethren, when ye come together, every one of you hath a psalm, hath a doctrine, hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation. Let all things be done to edify. Now look at what they actually were performing here. Everybody, it says in the text, now some people may not have had miraculous laying on of hands by the apostles, but for those who had the ability, every one of them was trying to use their ability. He says, when ye come together, every one of you that would have a gift, you have a psalm, you have a doctrine, you have a tongue, you have a revelation, and you have an interpretation. Everybody's trying to do their gift at one time, and he said that makes for confusion, but we need to make sure that we're edifying, uplifting, and encouraging. Here's the confusion of the denominational world. How much edifying is taking place here? Now, you talk about being mad and having confusion. Look at what he had just said to them before. Of all the confusion, look how he says it. Brethren, be not children in understanding. Howbeit in malice be ye children, but in understanding be men. Do you think those little kids have any understanding of what's going on? Absolutely not. They're simply in a situation where they see mom and daddy, grandma, grandpa, really what a lot of people would just say there, and they're acting a fool. That has nothing to do with worship. But what that is, that's confusion about the Holy Spirit. And they might be saying that's their spirit. You know, they're turned up. They're ready to dance, all of them cutting loose. That's their spirit. Has nothing to do with the Holy Spirit. Now, there's a lot of confusion, and we've got to ask the question of where is it coming from? 1 Corinthians 14:33, it says, "For God's not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints." God gave us this book. The Bible is comprised of 66 books, 39 in the Old Testament and 27 in the New. And you can understand those books. You put in the work, the time, the patience to understand, and the diligence to go back, reread, and study these things, you're going to learn. Now, if you're somebody who basically says you want to get it overnight, and you're fine at just listening to the words of a man and not even doing the research, you're not going to get it. That plain and simple. But if you're someone who's honest, and you take the time to study it, you're going to be able to wade through the confusion that's caused by man. But if you simply follow the Bible, you're not going to have that confusion. This is why. When the men were inspired in the New Testament by the Holy Spirit, look what it said about their inspiration. This isn't them as men talking about them being sinless, but it's talking about their inspiration. In 2 Corinthians 13:8, it says, "For we can do nothing against the truth, but for the truth." As they were being led by the Spirit, they couldn't do anything conflicting with what the Spirit, or they couldn't say or write anything conflicting with what the Spirit told them. They had to present that truth. Now, as far as their actions went, we know for a fact that in Galatians chapter 2, Peter had to be rebuked. Now, he was an apostle, had inspiration, but that didn't make him sinlessly perfect. But when they started giving that message, when they spoke by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, they were with not against the truth, but for the truth, and that's how Peter and Paul in Galatians chapter 1, verse 23, it says, "They had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preacheth the faith which he once destroyed." Paul is now preaching the faith which he once destroyed, which was that what was Peter was preaching. They can preach the exact same thing. Now, how is that that Paul can travel all across that the world at that time frame preaching the exact same thing as Peter when they didn't even have the written New Testament? Because 2 Corinthians 13, verse 8 says that they cannot do anything against the truth as far as their inspiration, but for the truth. Now, today, your pastor's telling you that he's got this 2 Corinthians 13:8 in the same way that Peter and Paul had it. Why is it? This is something that I was wondering. Somebody told me that J.C. Richardson was on tonight and he had an open topic. I would like to ask individuals who are in the Apostolic Church, why does the Holy Spirit lead them, supposedly, why does the Holy Spirit supposedly lead apostolics to believe one in the Godhead, and then some Pentecostals, they say they're led by the Holy Spirit, but they don't believe one in the Godhead. They say there are three beings that make up God or deity. How can those two groups both say they're led by the Spirit and then disagree when 2 Corinthians 13:8 says if you're inspired, you can't do against the truth but for the truth? That's the confusion. It's your pastors. And they're not even real pastors, friends. That's what's messing people up. That's where the confusion comes from. So tonight, this is what we're looking at. There's no idea in the Bible of individuals jumping around, hooping and hollering, playing music just as loud as all get out to where you can't even hear what that man was saying on the stage. But there's an idea of self-control. 1 Corinthians 14 says, "Let all things be done decently in order." Now, you can't say if you're going to contradict what the Spirit has delivered already, which is the Word, that it's the Spirit operating on you, but instead it's your spirit and you're choosing to go against the Holy Spirit. So let's look at this tonight. You have a spirit. I don't know how many people actually comprehend this anymore, to think about your own will, your spirit, versus what the Holy Spirit is doing. People just talk about feeling the Holy Spirit. I've never felt that. You know, we door knock, we have Bible studies, we try to have Bible studies and Bible classes with the church. We do Bible studies in people's homes. And I've never had this overcoming sensation of the Holy Spirit. But I do have a spirit within me. It's not miraculous. It's not supernatural. It's not giving me some power. It's simply the spirit that God installed in me in my conception. Now look at what the text says. Zechariah chapter 12 verse 1 says, "The burden of the word of the Lord of Israel, for Israel, saith the Lord, which stretcheth forth the heavens and layeth the foundations of the earth and formeth the spirit of man within him." He forms that spirit within everybody that's born on this earth. And guess what? When you're born with that spirit, you don't have any knowledge of the Holy Spirit. You don't have any knowledge of right or wrong, but you have to develop that. You have to learn and grow, but you do have a spirit within you. And people say, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit moved me. But in actuality, is it your spirit or is the Holy Spirit? 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11 says, "For what man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the spirit of God." There are two spirits that are happening in your life. And at that time frame, God can know your heart at all times, and He does know your heart at all times. But no man, just as Mark was on TV, I can't tell you what's in Mark's heart. I can only know what's in my heart, and God knows what's in all of our hearts. That's what it's saying here, the spirit of man. You have that. But you do not have the Holy Spirit leading you, guiding you, coming upon you. Every bit of that's made up. We're going to open up our phone lines for anybody who may have called into Mark's show that wants to call in tonight and they want to dispute with us. And look, you have to control your spirit. You can't just go about and lose control and then blame it on the Holy Spirit. Look at what the Bible says. Proverbs 16:32. "He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh a city." Now, look at this again. Look at how bad this is in Pentecostal churches. Pay attention to the guy who's doing all the dancing, but watch that other man. He's not as enthusiastic. He's got some sense about what he's doing. Look at him. Right here. Well, let me, friend, let me keep you separated while you gyrate your body in front of these women so that you don't get up on them. That's what we're doing in the Pentecostal denomination. They're not controlling their spirit, and all the while that they're not controlling their spirit, guess who they blame it on? They say, the Holy Spirit is moving tonight, and that's why friend over here is moving the way he's doing. Now keep watching him. He's got to keep separated from them so he doesn't get all over the women. Now don't get up on this woman. Now watch this. This guy comes running in out of nowhere. The Holy Spirit's got to be moving in him. And you know, this is the thing. Watch this. Turns off. He just cut out of being filled with the Holy Spirit to adjust the camera. He's jumping, he's moving around, stops, adjusts the camera, and goes right back to it. Is that really how they're going to tell us that this overwhelming sensation happens? That you're lost in it 1 minute, and once you notice, hey, the camera's not really where it needs to be, you just come out of it and go right back into it? There's no control here. They are just simply in there. I mean, they're dancing around, and you got to have men separating the men from the women to make sure that what that is making sure body parts don't get on each other. And what I think of when I see that is Romans chapter 13, verse 14. He says, "Put you on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." What'd y'all do at church today? Well, we danced, and we danced so hard, the men had to separate the men from the women so that we didn't violate Romans 13:14. Come on now. You're not going to some nightclub. When you think about this, y'all are dancing like you're in a nightclub, and what was happening in the New Testament once it got past midnight? Y'all are dancing on somebody else's wife, and you got the ushers trying to separate you, and in the Bible, what they did past midnight was they had a gospel sermon, and they were ready to part on the morrow, and he continued his speech until midnight. No partying, no filled with the Holy Spirit dance club, and no, certainly not have their children dancing all kinds of nonsense. Utter confusion. No bit of the Holy Spirit involved in that. That's your spirit. And you know why they're doing that? They don't have any control, but we're going to see in a moment why they come in and they act that way. It's on your decision. It's on your say-so. These people that are dancing around, let's keep watching them a little bit. Now look at that crowd. I don't know how many people are in there, but every person in there had to make a mental decision with themselves based on what they want to do and how they want their religion to be that they were going to go there that night. Now look at what this is. Romans 7:22 talks about our spirit, our inward man. I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. Now look at what is happening in here. They go to their denomination, the Pentecostals and the Apostolics, all the holiness movement, and what they delight in the inward man is they just want to move it. They want to hear some good, loud music, and they want to come in there in front of everybody, and most of them are going to be dressed indecent, cleavage hanging out everywhere, and they want to move it. So what's actually happening there? They delight in the loud music in their inward man. And once that gets going, you need the ushers to step in because that law in the members starts warring against the law of their mind. And all that fleshly desire starts coming in. All that is a bunch of show, bunch of lasciviousness. None of it has to do with the Holy Spirit. But they made a mental decision based on their spirit, their inward man, their mind to go there and to be involved in that. Look at what Ecclesiastes 7 verse 8 says. And the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. You know what you've got to do in order to obey God? Look at Matthew chapter 18. And at the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them, and said, Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Those little children in that video, dancing around, doing everything that grown-ups are doing in that Pentecostal church, don't know any better. And really, what it's talking about is they're simply following what they believe to be the correct example set in front of them. Why? Because they can establish these people are the authority, our parents are the authority, and they're telling us what we're going to do. This is how everybody else acts. We're going to do it. Now what you've got to do is take the Bible and humble yourself just like a child does with respect to their parent. That's their authority. They're going to obey it. Those children are just blending in with what's normal to them. But what you've got to do is lose every bit of, in your spirit, that pride that keeps you in a man-made denomination. Where's your denomination in the Bible? Baptist, Methodist, Pentecostal? If you're going to say that you teach according to the name of Christ, like the apostles did, it says they filled that whole city with the name of Christ, and they forbid the apostles to teach in the name of Christ. How can you go about and say, I teach in the name of Christ, and you teach a denomination that's not even in here? If you want to teach in the name of Christ, then you're going to teach proper worship. You're going to teach the correct church, the only one you find in the Bible, the church of Christ. The churches of Christ salute you. Go to Colossians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. All that loud music, can't understand any of the words. Look what it says. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. We're supposed to be able to comprehend in our inward man what's being said, and we're going to learn. But instead, in the Pentecostal church, they just hoop, holler, and play loud drums. You can't hear any of the teaching. Good evening, or a word from the Lord.
Hello.
Hello, you're on live.
I just listened to this man talking, and I know he doesn't know what he's talking about, because he needs to read in the book of Acts 2:38, and then go down chapter 2 and to 41. I think it's the 41st verse.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Acts 2, and it tells you that the first church was the apostolic church. It tells you the first Christian church because we follow the apostles' doctrine.
Okay, now, ma'am.
And he doesn't understand that when people, you showing the part about people praising God, Bible say, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And what it is a certain time of the church where they do this. It's not because they're just dancing around and playing around for the fun of it. When you feel the Holy Spirit, some people do dance. Some people sit quiet.
Now, ma'am.
And I know that this is not a false thing, because this guy, he is very misled if he thinks that what these people are doing is just fake things.
Okay, ma'am.
No, it's not fake, huh?
Ma'am. Okay, you're on live TV. I'm the man on TV, okay?
Okay, good.
That's good. Now, let me ask you some questions, okay?
Okay,
now, you said, now, I'm in Acts 2:38, like you said. And
wait a minute. Just a moment. It's Acts 2.
Yes, ma'am.
38. And let me grab my Bible right quick, because I woke up out of a sleep and saw this. I said, somebody's really misled.
Okay.
Because we have apostolic faith. We deeply love God. We believe in decency. It's just such a wonderful, wonderful thing. And we know that all these other religions, Baptist, holiness, different things like that, we know that holiness is a way of living.
Okay, so...
You know, it's just a lifestyle.
All right, now this is what we're going
to... But if you go to Acts, huh?
I've got it on the screen. Are you watching TV? You can see my verses on the TV. You should be able to.
Yeah, I was sitting here. I started taking notes because it was really exciting. I was just laying here sleeping.
Yes, ma'am.
But if you look at Acts 2 and 42, it's saying they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers.
Yes, ma'am. Now,
this is showing you that the apostles and the apostolic people are following the doctrines of the apostles.
Now, I agree. They're following the doctrine of the apostles.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing that you said that I can't agree with is you said that they're in the apostolic church.
Now, yeah,
this is what I want us to look
church.
At.
We followed the apostles' doctrine.
Okay. Now, I think that we're
now,
probably...
I don't know where these people are that you had that was dancing around, but I just happened to see this.
Yeah, now you did say that some people dance around when that happens. You said some people do that. Is there any time?
Is there any time
in the New Testament church where they do
that? You see people worshiping in different ways, you know, praising God in different ways. Usually, when church first started in these type of churches, it's because they do the praise service first. They may give a word or two from the Bible, but me, I know I am of the apostolic faith myself.
Okay, now, ma'am.
And we go by the doctrine of 2:38.
Ma'am, we're going to have some back and forth. You're doing all the talking. I got to ask you some questions.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay,
I'm so excited.
Okay, that's good.
I can't hardly hold it. Okay.
I'm glad to talk with you. Okay, now this is the thing.
Uh-huh.
You talked about their praise worship.
Uh-huh.
Now, that's the idea of, like, the music, the drums, all the organ and everything, and kind of the dancing around. Where is that in the New Testament?
Well, the Bible tells us about making a joyful noise unto the Lord. And I'm not the best person in the world to give you all the chapters and verses, but I know myself that I've been to many different types of denominations. You know, I've been to Catholic churches, Episcopalians and everything. And when the Word of God is coming forth, it's the most beautiful thing you want to hear. It doesn't have to have any dancing and laughing and playing around, because God's Word is so beautiful. And you know how the Bible tells us, it will not return void unto Christ. And so I know about the Word of God. I studied the old King James Version of the Bible.
Wait a minute,
that's where,
ma'am,
I get everything.
Hey, wait. You're starting to say you know the Word of God and you've studied all about it, but you just told me a moment ago that you're not the best to give scriptures. So we've got to have some dialogue. I mean, I'm wanting to cover some things.
Okay,
and you're
I'm sorry. I'm just excited. That's
okay,
all.
So let's go slowly, a point at a time.
Okay.
Ephesians 5:19. Speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Now, where, how, Ephesians 5:19, yes, ma'am.
Okay, great.
How do the Pentecostals get to bring in their organ, their drums, and their guitar?
back in those days, I don't know exactly what musical instruments they had. I don't even know if they had a drum. They probably had something.
Okay.
But the thing about it is, it's about making a joyful noise unto the Lord. It's about praising God.
Okay, now this is what the Bible...
praise God.
I agree with that.
Uh-huh.
Now let's look at this. He's talking about praising God, and look how he says to do it. He explicitly commands us to speak to ourselves in psalms, spiritual songs, singing, and making melody. It doesn't say anything about playing a guitar, playing a harp, blowing a trumpet. He's giving us the exact command of how to do it. Now, where do they get the New Testament authority to bring in any mechanical instrument?
Oh, so are you saying, what are you saying? Are you saying that you don't think it's okay to use, you saying the Bible should be specific in how you should praise God?
I'm saying that we should follow what the Bible tells us. Ephesians 5:19.
Okay, now, what did you say? Ephesians what?
5:19.
5 and?
Verse 19.
Okay, I got it right here. Just a moment. You have to go back up a little bit further. It says, on 18 it says, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord.
Okay, now,
thanks,
but
always,
that's...
Yeah, I understand.
There's
mechanical
instruments there.
To back up about the praising God, because in the Bible...
But ma'am, my question to you is, how do they get to have a piano? Because it's not in the Bible.
Well, maybe pianos weren't invented back at that time.
Well, they had harps and they had trumpets, and he does not command us to do this, to use those in our worship. Now, how did the Pentecostals get to do it anyway?
Well, see, I'm not Pentecostal, first of all.
Okay, what are you?
I'm just a woman that loves Jesus. I'm of the apostolic faith.
Okay, do you go to an apostolic church?
I do.
Okay, so you're not Pentecostal, you're just apostolic.
That's right. Okay. We're baptized in Jesus' name.
Okay, so how do they get to have instrumental, mechanical instruments like a piano and a guitar when the Bible does not command that?
Well, they may not have had those back in those days. They played with what they had.
Okay.
They made everything by hand.
I've seen other people.
And so are you saying there's something wrong with having these instruments in church?
Absolutely. The Bible does not command us to do that. Let me ask you a different question. Let's put it this way, okay? Do you take the Lord's Supper?
Do I take the Lord's Supper? You're talking about the sacrament.
If you want to call it that, yes, ma'am. Do you take the
sacrament? You know, the drinking of the wine and the eating of the bread.
Okay,
right?
That's it. You just said it.
Yes, I do.
You take the fruit of the vine and the unleavened bread. Now, why do you do that?
Well, I don't take the fruit of the vine. We use a substitute of grape juice in order. It just to do it in remembrance of Christ, because he commanded us to continue this practice in remembrance of Him.
Okay, He commanded us to do that in remembrance of Him. That's what you just said, right?
Yes.
Okay, now let's look at it. That's Matthew 26, and it says, He took bread and broke it, and He gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take ye, this is my body." He took the cup, He gave thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it." Now, we know that He commanded us to do that in remembrance of Him. Now, ma'am, are you willing to take grape juice, unleavened bread, and add to this command Coke and Oreos?
No, I'm not.
Now, why not?
Because that's not what He told us to do.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. In Ephesians 5...
Okay, I see your point.
All right.
I'm going to continue to listen to you. This is the first time I've heard it, but I was just... Man, I didn't even know I was going to get to talk to you while you were online.
Well, I know it, because you called in and said that, man. But I'm glad you got through. And this is your first time, you said. What I'd like to do, can you stay on hold, and we're going to get somebody, and they're just going to write your number down, and we'll talk with you a little bit after the show. Is that okay?
That'd be wonderful.
Okay, great. All right, now you stay on the line, okay? He's going to get on with you.
All right.
Okay, thank you for calling tonight.
Okay.
Now,
be blessed.
All right, thank you. Now, the thing, friends, about that, you don't have to be, you know, she called in, we had a disagreement when we used an argument. An argument from the text. She said, now I see that. I understand it. Nobody got mad with each other. That's how everybody needs to be. Thank you,
Amen.
Ma'am, for being so
Amen.
Cordial. Thank you. Now, we're going to have them get with you on the phone. We're going to come back to our slides here. Look at what we're looking at here. The patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. That's how we got to be.
Amen.
Now, we make that choice based on our inward man and based on what the Bible teaches. Confusion on the Holy Spirit. How are so many people confused? Because they get confused about their own spirit with the Holy Spirit. Now, this is what we mean. The Spirit moved me. They say that the Spirit just came on them and had an overwhelming sensation. But really what it is when people start saying that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit's coming on them, is what is happening is they come in their building, they're already feeling good. Look at James 5:13. Is any merry? Let him sing songs, sing psalms. These people that are Pentecostal, they come in, and it's not what the Bible's teaching as far as our worship, because it says that we should sing, making melody in our hearts to the Lord, speaking to ourselves and singing, teaching and admonishing. Doesn't say anything about dancing, but we should be decent and in order. But look at how, look, they're feeling good. And they're already coming in feeling this way. They didn't need the Spirit coming over them. And they're just feeling good. Now, this is the thing. There's no New Testament teaching for that. And just like the woman said, she's not about to swap out grape juice and unleavened bread for Coke and Oreos. She got that. Now, why do we take New Testament worship and we swap that out for what denominations have made? This is how ridiculous it's getting. People say they're filled with the Holy Ghost and so they dance and go wild. Look at these verses. In Acts chapter 2, verse 4, it says they were filled with the Holy Ghost. And what did they do? They didn't go crazy. They didn't start dancing, jumping around, and blasting an organ, a piano. It says they began to speak. Now, they spoke with a tongue, but the whole purpose of being filled with the Holy Ghost was they began to speak and to teach. Now, let's keep looking at verse 14. Peter standing up with the 11, he lift up his voice. That's after he was filled with the Holy Spirit. We look at Acts chapter 4, verse 8. Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, he starts teaching. That's what their being filled with the Holy Ghost was about. They were getting information from God that was not documented in a written form. Acts 4, verse 31. When they had prayed, the place was shaken and they were assembled together. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, what's the result of being filled with the Holy Ghost when a whole assembly in Acts chapter 4 was brought together? They had just been released out of that Jewish council. They rehearsed the whole matter with their brethren. They prayed to God. They're there together. Doesn't say anything about them jumping around. Doesn't say anything about dancing, starting to play in a praise band. It says that they were filled with the Holy Ghost. They spake the word of God with boldness. Being filled with the Holy Ghost then was a miraculous inspiration that caused individuals to give people the gospel. Had nothing to do with losing control or some people, denominational preachers say, losing their dignity. One denominational preacher said he was going to get up and dance and it could look as stupid as it could be, but he was going to do it. That's not being filled with the Holy Ghost. But this is the thing. When they're talking about being filled with the Holy Ghost, this is how far denominations are coming. And I don't think that the lady who called in as kind as she was being and she was thinking clearly, I just doubt that she's going to be able to agree with this. These people dancing around, that's one thing. But then we start moving in, this is where, you know, people are just, they know they're acting up, friends. Hey! 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 Now, what the caption says above the video and below it, it says that time that the horse caught the Holy Ghost. Now, where are we getting this idea of catching the Holy Ghost? Like, it's the common cold. And then once you catch it, we all lose control. We start dancing because the music's just so good. But you know what? This is what we're saying. By the Bible, we're saying this. Being filled with the Holy Ghost in the New Testament, it caused them to speak the truth. And when an animal began to speak by the Spirit in the Old Testament, they still don't get it right. The Lord opened the mouth of the ass, and she said, Numbers 22:28, no dancing horses, no dancing donkeys in the Bible, but when God was involved about giving a message, even the animal spoke. No dancing. So this idea of the dancing horse catching the Holy Ghost, that's wrong. Now friends, this is what we're saying. You got to realize about your spirit versus the Holy Spirit. What you might like is not what the Holy Spirit has already delivered for us. Look at this, Paul's spirit. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city was wholly given to idolatry. Why was his spirit stirred in him? Now look, it calls it his spirit, not the Spirit of God, not the Holy Spirit. It says Paul's spirit was stirred in him. People that watch the show regularly, I'm sure they by now have seen the video where Micah, myself, and another brother went to a place called Peaceful Baptist in Danville, Virginia. And I tell you, we were in there about 10 minutes, and by the time that a young man stood on his pew, red in the face, fist in the air, screaming as loud as he could, my spirit was stirred, and I leaned over and said to Micah, we might have to get the police down here for our own safety before they call it on us for asking Bible questions. His spirit was stirred in the fact that he saw all of the idolatry. Now what causes that? Psalm 119:104. When you know the truth, through thy precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. I cringe to see certain things that people are doing. That's what the Bible tells us. Jeremiah said in the day that he was prophesying that the people couldn't even blush anymore. They didn't have a shame about sin, but look at what Ephesians chapter 5 says. He says, first look at verse 11. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame to even speak of those things which are done by them in secret. Why was it stirred? Because it was such a shame, the fact that they were not worshiping the God of heaven, but they had taken little things that they made with their own hands and said, this is our God. Here we are in existence, and we formed our own God. It stirred him. Why Paul's spirit stirred? Because he knew the truth. We learn the truth, and when we see certain things like that, it stirs our spirit. One thing about people and saying that they come into a certain place and they say, you know, I just didn't feel comfortable. I didn't really like the atmosphere. I was talking to one of members of the church, and he was talking to me about before he obeyed the gospel. He said, you know, I'll admit, he said, before I obeyed the gospel, I didn't know any better. He said, what I was looking for, he said, I knew Johnny only preached out of the Bible. And he said, but what I wanted was to find a black church that did the same. Now look at what the Bible says. When you don't know better. Now, he said before he obeyed the gospel, that's what he was thinking, but he knows better now. We're not thinking about a white church or a black church, but individuals today still could be a respecter of persons. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. You might feel uncomfortable saying, well, I don't really want to go down to the white church, and white people might be saying, I don't really want to go down to the black church, and that might actually cause their spirit to be stirred for an incorrect reason. But it has nothing to do with the Holy Spirit. And in fact, you're going against what the Holy Spirit says if that's the mindset that we have. There's no such thing in the Bible about a white church or a black church. Paul said, I'm a debtor both to the Greeks, to the barbarians, to the wise, to the unwise. And then he says in verse 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God and salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and to also the Greek. If you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile, and that covers everybody in existence. We don't care what the color of your skin is, and neither does the Holy Spirit. But some people might have an incorrect mindset and their spirit might be a respecter of persons. That would cause their spirit to be stirred. Lot was vexed, it says, for the righteous man dwelling among them, and seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. That's why I go out and when I'm talking to people. I met a Presbyterian denomination one time, I was talking to their secretary. They had a homosexual preacher. Wow. The woman, the secretary, who went there and sang in their choir did not even believe that heaven or hell existed. You talk about messed up and confused. But this is what we got to understand. You have a spirit. And then there's the Holy Spirit aside from it. And you've got to get down which one is which. Because if you start saying that the spirit is talking to you directly, and you can't distinguish the own sound of your voice in your head from what you imagine is to be the Holy Spirit, you're going to end up just like the God hates fags people. Now, you talk about bad. You don't want to be like the God hates fags people. They talk about they're the, you know, the cream of the crop, the most outspoken. They don't really know the Bible as well as they think they do. But look at how foolish and how backwards Calvinism gets. That's what they are. They're Calvinists. And they believe in total depravity. They believe you're born in sin. And they believe that you have to be illuminated by the Holy Spirit before you can be saved. Now, look at this. We're going to go over here and we're going to show you a video of a man, and his name is Stephen Drain.
The Vices filed this story. No character stood out more to us than the family of Steve Drain, the only members of the Westboro Baptist Church not related by blood. It was during the editing of his documentary Hate Mongers that Steve claims he underwent a supernatural conversion. After much thought, contemplation, and discussions with his wife Lucy, Steve packed up his two daughters when a supernatural conversion. Claims he underwent a supernatural conversion.
A supernatural conversion is where the Holy Spirit overwhelmed him. The Holy Spirit took control at that moment and saved him. He will tell you, Steve Drain will tell you, that it was nothing that he did, no action that he performed to gain his salvation. The Holy Spirit just simply came over, took control, and God saved him at that moment. Now that's what he says. The Holy Spirit brought him to salvation. It told him he was saved. It guided him into that. Now, this is how dangerous it is. Here's one man saying, the Holy Spirit told me to join Westboro Baptist Church. Now, look at what one of the Phelps granddaughters says.
My grandpa called. He said, you're not thinking about leaving, are you? And then I said, no. And in that moment, I was telling the truth because I didn't think I could leave. I didn't think that was an option for me to leave. I just kind of had a sudden realization that I needed to get out of there.
Now that's what it is, friends. You start all this business about the Holy Spirit's talking to you and the Holy Spirit's giving you extra information aside from what we have in the Bible. How do I know that the Holy Spirit is actually giving you information and that I can trust it? Because you look at one man and he says, the Holy Spirit told me to join Westboro Baptist Church with a miraculous conversion. And this girl, who is a Phelps, granddaughter of Fred Phelps, and she says, I had an overpowering telling me to get out of that church. That's how backwards it is. You start all that business about the Holy Spirit's teaching you stuff and the Holy Spirit is speaking to you in ways outside the Bible. I can't buy that. And you can't prove it. Now let's look at this. In Acts chapter 5, verse 32, look at what the text says. And we are his witnesses of these things. And so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. Now here it says that they are witnesses of these things, and only the apostles were chosen to actually give witness. So we're going to look back at where he made that promise to them. Look at John 15, verse 26 and 27. He says, Jesus said to them, when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify me. And ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. Now how is it that they actually went out and they bore witness of those things? They didn't just simply go out and say, hey, y'all, God, the Holy Spirit is talking to us, and what you're doing is wrong. The Holy Spirit says you need to act this way. No, look back at Acts chapter 4. Verse 33, with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. How did they do it? Great power. They were performing miracles. Anybody today that says they have the Holy Spirit and they say that they are witnessing for the Holy Spirit and they're witnessing about Jesus, then you need to be able to do that with great power. You need to be able to drink poison, as Mark 16 says. 17 through 20 says, all these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents and drink any deadly thing, and it will not hurt them. Nobody does that today, because nobody has the Holy Spirit in the fashion that they had in that day. Look at Romans 8:16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. How? Everybody, Pentecostals and Apostolics, both say that they're getting revelation from God. The Holy Spirit leads them. But they divide and they actually withdraw from each other. We've got some people that say they can't be in fellowship, Apostolics and Pentecostals, because they disagree on the deity or the person of God and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. How then does the Spirit itself bear witness with our spirit? There it is again. You've got capital S Spirit, the Holy Spirit, with our lowercase spirit. That's me, spirit of the inward man. Now, how does he bear witness with my spirit? Based on this teaching and tying it with the New Testament, I know that it is not by miraculous happenings, and this is why. No amount of miracles is going to prove to you today, without the truth, that you're the child of God. You can perform miracles and speak in tongues and do everything else, but if you're not in accordance with the truth, then you're not saved. And this is why we say that. You're not a child of God. Because in Galatians chapter 3, verse 2, look at what he says. This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Now what's he asking them? Did you receive miraculous ability by the hearing of faith or during being under the old law? They had miraculous ability. And look what Galatians 3:5 says. He says, he therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Paul gave them miraculous ability. He worked miracles among them. Now how did he do it? By the hearing of faith, which is going to be the law of Christ under the gospel, or is it by the law of Moses, which they wanted to go back to? These people had miraculous ability, and look at what they still did not understand. Go down to verse 26. He says, ye are the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. By faith you're a child of God. It was not about the miracles, and it wasn't about the law of Moses. But look at how they actually became children of faith in Christ Jesus. Verse 27. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Today, people that are saying, well, the Holy Spirit, he bears witness with my spirit. Okay, but how does he do that? It's not by miraculous happenings. Be honest. Be honest like that lady who called in. People aren't operating in miraculous abilities anymore. They don't speak in real tongues, which is a language unknown to them, miraculously given to them. They don't raise the dead. They don't cast people blind. They don't heal sick. They don't restore limbs. Nothing is going on. They don't have inspired messages. This is it. This is what we've got today. And this is how the Spirit is going to bear witness with our spirit. It's going to teach us. It gives us the information. They needed, after they had miracles, somebody else to come in and show them they're the children of God by faith in Christ, as many of them has been baptized into Christ. It takes faith. You're trusting in God to obey Him and trust that He's going to save you the way He said He's going to. It's by teaching and obedience. Now that's what it takes, not miracles. If you're Pentecostal, apostolic, you're holiness of some sort, you need to give up on waiting for those miracles. We know that people teach how to speak in tongues in these denominations. Nobody had to be taught to speak in tongues in the New Testament. It says the Spirit gave them utterance and they spoke in tongues. Nobody had to be taught to say certain phrases. Now what you need to do is you need to study more. Pick up your Bible. Quit listening to what your pastor says and open the book. Look at what Paul did. Paul was an apostle. Paul had seen Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. Paul had the miraculous ability to strike a man blind in Acts 13, and look how he convinced people. He did not just simply go in and say, "Hey, I'm an apostle from God. Listen to me." He went into their synagogues. It says Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days he reasoned with them out of their scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and rise again from the dead, and that Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. What'd he do? Acts chapter 2, who did Peter make reference to? David being a prophet. Acts chapter 3, who does he make reference to? Now we'll go ahead and show some of these verses. Therefore, being a prophet, in Acts chapter 2, verse 30, and knowing that God has sworn with us an oath to him that the fruit of his loins, that's David, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. Nobody could ignore the lineage of Jesus. They knew where he came from, and they knew that he had been crucified, just like the prophecy said, that one man was going to die for the people. Look at Acts chapter 3. Verse 24, they didn't just simply come on the scene and say, "Hey, we're apostles." They said, "Samuel and all the prophets from Samuel have told of the days that are coming." That's the Christian age. They gave them authority, just like tonight when I was talking to that lady. We went to Ephesians 5:19, we went to Matthew 26:26, and we established what the Bible teaches. Now that's what they did. They had scriptures then, they were Old Testament prophecies, and they applied them to the days that they were living in. Just like we do that today. We take the New Testament, we apply it to where we're living. You got to quit listening to your pastors. They're not telling you the truth. All the, you know, Bishop Campbell, all the different people, Mark Price, Michael Penn, all of them just competing to be like T.D. Jakes, mega church, teaching lies, taking your money on top of teaching you a lie. You need to read your book. Read your Bible, open and allege, make an argument for what you believe. And what one thing that we need to start learning is that the Holy Spirit is a person. He's not an it. He's not a force, but He is a being. When the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth which proceedeth from the Father, He shall testify of me. He will testify of me. It's not an it. Good evening, you're on A Word from the Lord.
Yes, Mike. Kayla, from me.
Yeah.
You keep showing this church meeting that's going on, and to me, I don't see no reverence in it. Praising God, they're showing how good they can dance, jump around, and you're talking about the deacons. They about to become bouncers. I'm looking at what you're showing, like you would see in a nightclub or something, to separate the people from and get them out in the street if it's drinking too much. And if they were drinking strong liquids, how much worse could they be than what's almost happening in what you're showing?
Yeah,
and I thought I would comment on that. And thank you. I'm enjoying your show.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the comment. He's right. They're acting like bouncers. And the Bible says, 1 Corinthians 14:40, let all things be done decently in order. They were by far, far away from decent and in order. These are the things we've got to be studying. The Holy Spirit is God. We find in the New Testament what it says, Acts chapter 5, verses 3 and 4. He said, why has Satan to Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? And then look what he says. thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. He is deity, just like the Father and just like Christ. We need to understand who the person of the Holy Spirit is. That's how we remove confusion. Read the book of Acts. Sit down. Take several nights. You could read it in a week. Read several chapters a night. Make notes. Try to keep up with where things were, and you'll find out the truth. Quit listening to your pastor and read the Bible. You've got to realize this. You've got a spirit, and Isaiah 7 says you had to learn to choose good and refuse evil. You've got to learn this just as much as all the other things you've learned in life. But here's the thing. He says, how can I accept some man should guide me? That's Acts 8:31, the eunuch and Peter. Eunuch and Philip, I'm sorry. And he said, how can I accept a man guide me? Don't trust your pastor. His word is not the gospel. The gospel is the gospel. Now tonight, we're simply using the gospel to try to help you along to see the truth. That's all we're trying to do. We don't want your money. It's all about the benefit of your soul. That's what we're doing tonight. And tonight, we're wrapping up. We're going to close out by, as we're saying, we're trying to help guide you to the truth only with the word. We want to offer books to you that we give away regularly. One's called Muscle and a Shovel, and you'll see the account of a man learning he's in a denomination and searching for the truth. That's what a lot of people are doing today. But what it takes when it comes down to the end is having enough courage, using your inward man, the spirit, your spirit, to leave a denomination. Another book called Why I'm a Member of the Church of Christ. It's nothing but scripture. It's not a creed book and it's not a manual. My phone number is 276-806-3641. Micah's phone number is 434-429-5221. We're thankful for the calls. Thankful for everybody that's tuned in with us tonight and for all the questions and good attitudes in the discussion. We're thankful for that. Remember, friends, always ask for what does the Bible say, and you'll get a word from the Lord. Thank you for watching. Have a good night.
You're traveling to another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. Your next stop,